Jason, and I welcome you in the name of the Lord Jesus. We are so glad that you are here to join us for worship this morning. And I invite you now to stand in body or in spirit to join me in singing in the presence of your people. The lyrics to this song are very old. They're about 3,000 years old. It is Psalm 22. So, rise in body or in spirit and join me now. And I welcome you again to worship. I want to share a couple of opportunities to be of service, to grow together, to be the presence of Jesus in our community. Number one is People's Kitchen is Monday, July 20th. Every month we serve lunch to our friends at 40 Prado. And this month we're serving barbecue chicken sandwiches and potato salad and all the fixings. And if you would like to get involved, if you would like to prepare food or serve food or both, let either Sally or Nancy know. And then also starting this week, we're going to be diving into a new book called White Fragility by Robin DiAngelo. This is currently the number two best-selling nonfiction book on Amazon. Took us a while to get these in because everyone is trying to get copies of it. We're going to be meeting via Zoom starting this Thursday afternoon, and we ordered 20 copies, so if you want a copy, either to read as part of the book club or on your own, just let me know and we will find some way to get you a copy, even if I have to drive it to you in my Prius. All right, I invite us now to be thinking about the people, the things that we are grateful for this morning, and you are welcome to share them in the comment section. Ooh, I went from blue to green. All right. Now I'm blue again. All right. I feel like Violet Beauregard. Violet, you're turning violet. One of my joys, one of my gratitudes is that on Wednesday, we actually had 9 people here at the church who were volunteering, who were working in some way. We had a group working in the garden, and our grounds look so fabulous. They look the best that they have ever looked. So thank you everyone who has been coming faithfully every Wednesday to help with the grounds. We also had a group here painting some rooms. We had others who were cleaning up the rooms, preparing to be painted. We had someone here preparing for worship. My goodness, there were 9 people here involved in keeping the church going, and only 2 of us were on staff. It was like, wow. It was wonderful to see, and it just really, my heart is full of gratitude for everyone. I'm also grateful this morning that our beloved cat, Ella, who is a scaredy cat, she's a shy gal, she heard the fireworks last night, and she didn't hide under the bed. I think this is the first year, I think Ella is 7 now, this is the first year that she has not hidden under the bed. So I don't know if your animal companions went under the bed or went someplace to try to get away from it all, or if they were okay with it, but praise God for animal companions. All right, are there any other joys, gratitudes that we have here that we would like to share?
It was my father's birthday yesterday.
Dad's birthday yesterday. Wonderful, wonderful.
89.
Oh, all right. That's a serious number, 89.
And Heather's father's birthday as well. He would have been 101.
Oh, my word. Oh, my word. Congratulations. All right, any other?
My sister's birthday was July 1st, and I'm just grateful for another day of life.
Amen. Praise God.
That's my youngest son's birthday, July 1st.
All right. 28. So many birthdays. So many birthdays. All right, well, at this point, I'm going to turn it over now to Richard, who is going to lead us in the call to worship and the opening prayer.
Thank you, Jason. Would you please stand in body or spirit for our call to worship? Jesus welcomes us. Come to me if you are tired.
We come to you now, teacher.
Jesus invites us. Come to me if you carry heavy burdens. We come to you now, healer. Jesus calls us. Come and discover rest for your souls. We come to you now, restorer. Amen. And please join me in the opening prayer. God of heaven and earth, we gather in your presence with thanksgiving and praise for the way in which you have revealed yourself to us. Through Jesus, we have come to know and love you. We have caught a glimpse of your heart, and we have heard the call to follow. May your Holy Spirit open our minds and hearts to and to the word that you have for us in the morning. Amen.
Come away from rush and hurry to the stillness of God's peace. From our vain and hurry, come to Christ to find release. Come away from noise and clamor, life's demands and frenzied prayer. Come to join the people gathered here to seek and find God's grace. In the pastures of God's goodness, we lie down to rest our soul from the waters of God's word.
Now, before our time of prayer and meditation, I invite you to hear as I read from Romans chapter 7. I'm going to read verses 15 through 25a. And Paul is talking about his own inner conflict, his own inner struggles. He writes, "I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing that I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good that I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law, at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen." I invite you now to a time of prayer and meditation.
All we need, forgive us everything, help us to
Loving God, we pause before you this morning in stillness and in silence. We take a break from rest, from rush and hurry, and we rest in you, God. We thank you for the gift of life, for the gift of community, for the gift of one another. Even though we have to find creative ways to be together now, God, thank you for the people in our lives. God, we ask that you pour out your Spirit upon us to help us be the kind of people who work for the good, who work for the healing, work for the liberation of one another, and God, all creation. We are mindful this morning of the people, the places, the situations that need your healing touch, your transforming power. God, we lift them up to you now, either by name, silently in our heart, or in the comment section. We think of Keith and Vince and family. We think of Betsy and Rick, of Shay, of Abby, and Devon, our first responders, God.
For Kenny and his family, Sandy, for Kendra, Mason, Sierra, Turgay, and for Janet Benavides, for the repose of her brother's soul, Taylor.
I'd like to send a special prayer up for the Oglala and Lakota Sioux. They were put through the ringer this weekend, Lord. Just sustain them and let them feel your love.
We pray all of these things in the name of Jesus, the one who has revealed you to us, to the world. And we pray together the prayer that he taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Matthew chapter 11, verses 16 through 19 and 25 through 30. But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. We played the flute for you and you did not dance. We wailed and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Thank you, Richard. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. You will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy, and my burden is light. These are some of Jesus' best known words, and for good reason. For 20 centuries, individuals have heard these words and have replied, I'm tired, I'm weary, I'm carrying heavy burdens, I need rest. My body is tired, my mind is tired, my spirit is tired, I need rest. I need the source of life to refresh and restore me. I need rest, or I won't be able to go on. Maybe you feel this way this morning. I have to admit, I have felt this way countless times recently. I'm tired of washing my hands. I'm tired of thinking about the coronavirus. I'm tired of racism. I'm tired of violence. Drew and I talk on the phone every week, at least once a week. We call and check in with each other, and we ask each other, how are you doing? How are you doing? And last week, all I could think to say was, I'm just tired. I'm tired. I don't know what to do or what to say anymore. In moments of such fatigue and exhaustion, these words of Jesus are like a refreshing cold drink of water on a hot day. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. It's natural for us to look for spiritual guidance and for meaning in a time of crisis, when we are tired, when we're exhausted, and when we are just at our wit's end. When we cry out, okay, God, what gives? What's going on? Are you even there? What's the plan? Why is this happening? And how am I going to make it through this? Jesus knew that people did this when they were tired, when they were exhausted. They reach out to God. And the Pharisees knew it too. The Pharisees taught that in order to be right with God, in order to be in relationship with God, in order for God to bless someone and to be with them, someone had to obey all kinds of really burdensome rules. They had to do everything just right. And they were, of course, the only ones who knew exactly what was right. Because it was recorded in ancient texts that they had memorized. And, of course, only they interpreted them correctly. They were critical of everything and everyone. No one could do anything right. They criticized Jesus' cousin John. He has a demon, they said. And they criticized Jesus too. They said, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. And they were constantly judging and condemning others, laying before them heavy burdens which no one could meet, not even the Pharisees. Jesus only talks about burdens twice in Matthew's gospel. Once to describe all of the heavy, burdensome rules and requirements that the Pharisees required of people, and once to talk about his burden, which is light in comparison. He's contrasting the way of the Pharisees and the way of Jesus. The Pharisees' burden is heavy because there's always something wrong. There's always something wrong with what you're doing or what you're thinking or what you're desiring. And the Pharisees told people that they were constantly breaking one of God's commandments, either in word or in thought or in deed. In contrast, Jesus' burden is light, because he doesn't make this burdensome, heavy requirement. He invites us to trust that through him, we are made right with God. Our words, our thoughts, our deeds are sometimes life-denying, even after we choose to trust God, just like Paul shared in his letter. And we need to work on this. We need to let go of the life-denying ways that we used to embrace. We need to change some of our strategies, some of our approaches. But we work on that, and we work on changing ourselves, knowing that we are already God's beloved. We don't have to change to become God's child, God's beloved. We are already beloved, and that's what allows us to change. When we approach life and when we approach God from this perspective, everything changes. We're able to let go of the need to always be right, which is the way of the Pharisee. We can let go of the need to always prove ourselves. We can let go of the need to engage in every argument that we are invited to. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
You don't have to join every argument that you are invited to join. You don't have to. You don't need to. Instead of doing this, you can rest. You don't have to be doing something all the time. You don't have to think and act as if civilization itself and God's glory depended on you. That is a really heavy burden. Instead, Jesus invites his disciples to rest, to take a Sabbath, to rest and to trust that God is alive and at work in our world and in us, and we don't have to be doing all the time. We can let go. We can rest for a day. We can rest for a few days, and God and the universe will be okay. We are not holding the universe together. We are not the center of the universe. I say this again and again. I say this to myself. We act as if sometimes we thought this, but it's not the case. It's okay to take a rest. It's okay to take a break, to allow our energy to be restored, and then to re-engage in the sacred work to which God has called us. In addition to resting, Jesus invites us to ground our ethics and our actions not in ancient prohibitions, but in love. The Pharisees were masters of pointing out that according to this or that ancient writing, what someone was doing was wrong. Because of what someone wrote a long time ago, they would mercilessly attack and condemn others. Jesus didn't appeal to ancient texts to guide him, and he doesn't want his followers to either. He wants us to let love determine what is right and what is good, and let love be our motivation. I talked this morning in my peace nugget about the belief that some folks have that it's God's commands that make things good. What's good? Well, it's whatever God has commanded in the Bible or in another sacred text. That's what's good. The problem with that is when we say that God is good, if what is good is simply what God has commanded, when we say God is good, we would ultimately be saying that God is that which God commands. And that doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense at all. There has to be something greater that guides our actions and has to help us determine what's right and what's good, and that's love. God commands things because it's the loving thing to do. So love is the root of all goodness, all ethics, all morality. Love has to guide us. This was what Jesus taught. This was how Jesus lived. And the Pharisees attacked him mercilessly because he healed who, according to them, he should not have healed. He forgave who, according to them, he should not have forgiven. And he included those who, according to them, he should not have included. Mm-hmm. Healing, forgiving, including, these are all acts of love. These are some of the ways that love manifests itself. It's the way that love flows from us to others. And it's always the right time to choose love. It's always the right time to manifest love. Jesus invites us to let go of so many things. Here he is inviting us to let go of two things that we have a really hard time letting go of: the need to always be doing something, the need to always be proving ourselves, and the need to act as if we were God. He's also inviting us to let go of the need to use ancient texts to help us figure out what's right and what's wrong. We don't need someone to tell us how to live, whether that person lived 3,000 years ago or 30 years ago. All that we need is to listen to love. Like Paul said, love is the fulfillment of the law. If you want to know what is good, what's right, what's true, listen to love. To figure out the right thing to do, we just look to love in a particular situation and then do it. We don't need ancient texts or clever arguments. We need love and empathy. When we live out of love, when we will the good of our neighbor, when we work for good on their behalf, it's not a duty. It's not heavy. It's not burdensome. It flows naturally from us. It creates energy rather than depletes it. Teresa of Avila in the 16th century said, "Love turns work into rest." Love turns work into rest. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The Lord Jesus invites us to let go. Let go of our need to always be doing and the need to act as if we were God. And to let go of anything but love to guide us and ground our decisions. Let go of the way of the Pharisees, a way that is still with us today, with its heavy burdens, with its exhaustion, with its judgment. Choose instead the way of Jesus, with its light burden, with its rest, with its love. That way is also a choice that we have today, this very morning. God, help us choose this way. Amen. Amen. Please pray with me. Loving God, love turns work into rest. Help us act, help us think, help us choose out of love, not of heavy burdens, not of ways that other people tell us is right, but God, the way that your spirit, the way that your love tells us is right. God, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I invite you now to consider sharing a gift to support the mission and the ministry of this church. I am so grateful for the faithful giving of the people of this congregation and the people out there for whom this church is a source of light, it's a source of love and meaning in this challenging time. You are welcome to mail a check to the church, and we will make sure that it gets into the offering, or you can also donate online at uccslo.com, and you can give electronically. And please know that your giving is the way that this church thrives. Your giving is the way that we share God's love and light with our community. So if our mission and our ministries are meaningful to you, I invite you to share generously if you are able.
Praise God, one love we all may share. Praise God, one beauty everywhere. Praise God,
gracious God, all good gifts come from you. You have given us life and new life in Christ. As you have given us gifts, so we offer our gifts, that we may be the gifts to one another. Amen.
Amen. Will you join me now in singing, "Let Us Break Bread Together"? In our congregation, we celebrate communion the first Sunday of every month together, and we're going to have to do it a little bit differently since we're not going to be dipping into a common cup. I'm also going to be standing on the chancel when I invite God's blessing on the elements, mindful that I'm about 6 inches away from a candle. I will try not to light myself on fire this morning. So, in our congregation, we typically use gluten-free bread, and we use grape juice so that everyone can join in the sacred meal that Jesus invited his very first followers to, and he invites us to join with today. We remember that on the night in which he gave himself up, he took the bread and he broke it, and he shared it with his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat this, all of you. This is the bread of life. This is the bread of love, which is not burdensome, which is not heavy, which will give you rest." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he blessed it. And he said, "Take and drink this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant, which God now enters into with everyone, with Jew and Gentile, with slave and free, with rich and poor, with female and male. Do this in remembrance of me." Will you please pray with me? Loving God, we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, these signs of your unending faithfulness and love. God, the grape and the grain. We ask that your Spirit transform them once again into the bread of life, the bread of love, and the cup of the new covenant. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, I invite you, whatever you have at home now, to partake the bread of life, the cup of the new covenant. I can't wait to hear what everyone had for communion this morning. Will you join me now in the prayer after communion? Eternal God, we give thanks that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you now to join us in singing God Bless America. And God's beloved, right now, we need God's blessing on our country. We need God's Spirit. We need God's help in our country. So please join me. God bless America. Join me now in reading from the UCC's Statement of Faith. You are welcome to say with me, you promise to all who trust you forgiveness of sins and fullness of grace, courage in the struggle for justice and peace, your presence in trial and rejoicing, and eternal life in your realm which has no end. Amen. God, who gives us rest and peace, will go with you as we leave this time together. Feel the healing love of God in your life and bring the good news of God's love to all whom you meet. Go in peace. Amen. Amen. And you're welcome to join me in saying the first part of the Serenity Prayer. We started saying this when the coronavirus started impacting all of life, and we didn't know what to do, what to think. There were so many things that we had no control over, and that it just felt right to say the Serenity Prayer together. So, God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. Beloved, thank you for worshiping with us this morning. If you're still wearing your pajamas, it's time to put on some real clothes. I love you. I miss you. Grace and peace be with you all. Bye-bye.
I would be if I was home.
I thought we were going to do God Bless America again. I got the wrong sound on the right song. Sorry.